Good morning. Welcome back to our lecture on sonnet number 67. We'll continue from where we left. So we were talking about the deer as employed in Petrarch, which is a visionary deer. Here we have a material deer, who is a young lady who allows herself to be captured. She comes with her, he says, the gentle deer returned the selfsame way, thinking to quench her thirst at the next brook, and she came with her own goodwill. So goodly one with her own will, Bikai. So the emphasis on will, her own goodwill. She returned. He had already given up on the chase. He forsook the chase. So we have a material deer here, a real deer who surrenders itself. So and also we are talking about deer, so it's a pun. Heart means it's a medieval name for deer, and we have deer images in a number of poems and plays. I'll give you examples from the works that you have read in your first semester. So the famous one is Metamorphoses by Ovid. So there we have Actaeon, who is a hunter, who turns out to be a warrior, who spied on Diana while she was bathing. So he was punished by the goddess. Diana was the goddess of virginity and the goddess of domestic animals. She is associated with hunting. So he saw her bathing and he was spying on her, and she punished him. So she turned him into a deer and he was eaten by his own hounds. So here, if you look at line number 4, he's chasing like a huntsman. He's chasing her. But then we see that with panting hounds beguiled of their prey. So hounds are wild animals, the dogs which huntsmen take along with them for hunting. So this idea, line number 4, it reminds us of the deer in Metamorphoses, and Spencer is probably giving reference to Metamorphoses here. So with panting hounds beguiled of their prey, so he has given up, he's exhausted, because a parallel could be drawn between Actaeon and Spencer. Because both of them were chasing a woman and they get punished. So here in the first few lines, we see that he's tired and he is like a huntsman who is punished. So he says, with panting hounds beguiled of the prey. Now, deer image also appears in As You Like It, where a deer is hunted. We also have a deer in, if you talk about classical Indian literature, we have a deer in Abhigyan Shakuntalam, which you have already read. So just like wrestling, hunting is also equated with love, to win love, to chase. So in Abhigyan Shakuntalam, Shakuntala has a pet deer, and Dushyant, who is the king of Hastinapur, he shot an arrow at the deer. Now, shooting arrow at deer. Deer is an animal which is supposed to be shy, which is coy. Hence, Spencer employs this image for in sonnet number 67. So, and it's clear to us that the deer here is a woman. Quench her thirst. The pronoun is used for woman. Her, feminine pronoun. So, the gentle deer, thinking to quench her thirst. So this gentle deer is a woman. So there she beholding me with a milder look. So she, the deer is she, it's female. Now let's look at the influence of Petrarch in this sonnet. So I told you earlier that Petrarch wrote rhyme 190. So Spencer is probably borrowed a few concepts from Petrarch. So in rhyme 190, And also, okay, there are three writers. There are three poets, Petrarch. Then we have Wyatt and Tasso. Spenser borrows from all three. The deer in Spenser is somewhat similar to Petrarch's deer, to Wyatt's deer, and to Tasso's deer. So Petrarch, rhyme 190. Wyatt, whoso list to hunt. And Tasso's, Questa, Ferra, Gentle. So these are the three poems from which we can compare Spenser's Like a Huntsman. So we see like Wyatt's deer, the Petrarch's deer is cannot be captured while so you see hunting is like hunt of love in Emirati, and we have a similar idea drawn in Tasso's Questa Ferra Gentle as well. So unlike Petrarch's deer, in this sonnet the lover is actually able to capture the deer, that is his lady love, by her own will, beguiled means charm. So he's able to capture her with her own will, unlike Petrarch's deer, which cannot be captured because Petrarch's deer belongs to Caesar. So we also have a reference to Ovid's Metamorphoses here, with panting hounds beguiled of the prey. Beguiled also means cheated, disappointed. And here, essay means attempt, a trial. Now this trial could be the trial by drinking or tasting, so that the lover or the huntsman has become drunk prematurely, or he's not satisfied. The trial could also mean a trial of fitness of the den for hunting and killing. Now we have a female deer, she is thirsty. Her thirst could be compared with that of wife of Bath or Dr. Faustus. And so she's seeking satisfaction. She has thirst for something. And the gentle deer here, she returns. So she's like Diana, the huntress, the goddess of virginity. And the heart's drinking, the deer's drinking, is also a sign of longing for God. As it appears in Geoffrey Whitney Jr. He wrote a work called A Choice of Emblems. In 1586. So according to Geoffrey Jr., in his A Choice of Emblems, the drinking of water, the thirst on part of the deer could also mean longing for God. Then he goes on to say that she is beholding me with a milder look. She's beholding him with a milder look. And now this line is slightly ambiguous. We are not sure she is beholding me with a milder look, whether he has a mild look or she is beholding him with a mild look. So we don't know who has mild looks, but it's probably the beloved. Then he says, I took her in hand, yet trembling took. So his hands are trembling because of the responsibility he has got. And we see that Petrarch's deer remains free as she belongs to a greater lord, that is Caesar. And it has something inscribed on her collar, that is, touch me not, for I am Caesar's. She says, touch me not, for I am Caesar's. It's inscribed on her collar. But here, Spencer manages to tie her, that too firmly, with her own goodwill. So this voluntary surrendering of the lady, and he tries to respond to it by tying a knot. He says that I firmly tied. So when she surrenders, he ties a knot, and he's half trembling because he's still nervous about because the lady is also nervous about her new life, and he's also trembling because of the responsibility that he has got. Now, will here, goodwill, will. Will could mean desire, the sexual desire that made her yield herself to him. And if also, let's look at how Spencer's sonnet is different from, is it different kind, follows a different kind of Petrarchanism. So, Emirati has a number of poems. And are somewhat Petrarch-like, and especially sonnet number 10 and 67. So yet, even though it's similar to Petrarchan sonnets, it is somewhat different. So if and at the same time, it closely depends on Petrarch. So here we have a white doe in Petrarch, a white doe. Who is a lady? So, white doe in Petrarch, it's visionary. Petrarch's deer is a visionary, pictorial or religious deer. The white doe is lady, and she has diamonds around her neck. And she says, no one can touch me. It has pleased my Caesar to make me free. So, her Caesar is God, and he has set her free. And he has made her ascend to heaven. So Petrarch's beloved Laura, she dies in the end. Whereas you see that Spencer manages to get married to Elizabeth Boyle. Hence, he manages to tie a knot. So this knot could, firmly tied, could mean the knot of marriage. Sacred knot of marriage. So we have three poets. Petrarch, Wyatt and Tasso. So unlike Petrarch's deer, this one is a material deer. Spencer's deer is material, and Spencer could not capture her. But Petrarch could not capture her. Spencer manages to capture her by her own free will, by her own goodwill, and firmly ties her. So if you see that Spencer's deer is somewhat similar to Wyatt's deer too, because Wyatt, he turns Petrarch's vision into a chase. So Petrarch's deer is visionary, but Wyatt, he changes it into a chase. And again here Spencer is chasing her. So it's also a chase. Chase forsook. Weary chase. So he's borrowing from Wyatt. Then Spencer is close to Wyatt because he turns Petrarch in a realistic or in a personal direction. And Tasso has written a poem, The Gentle Beast, where the deer is also material, not visionary, and the young lady who willingly allows herself to be captured. In the octave, Tasso writes about the capture, and in the sestet, that is the last six lines, the joy of capturing her. So Spencer echoes Petrarch, Wyatt, and Tasso at the same time. He borrows from all three. And also, if you see Spencer, like Wyatt, he gives up the chase. Initially, there is a chase, he gives up. And with a note of resignation, he gives up. But like Tasso's deer, his lady gives up as well. She allows herself to be captured with her own goodwill, with her own will. So, and the poem ends like that of Petrarch. So she beholds him with a milder look, and he takes him in her hand. He says, till I in hand her, yet half trembling look, and with her own goodwill, her firmly tie. So it's like it ends like Petra. He beholds her with she beholds him with mild look, and he takes her in his hand with her own goodwill. So the actual conquest is celebrated here, and you see that Wyatt's deer is tame and at the same time wild. But here we have a wild deer which turns tame in the course of the sonnet. So he says, he shows surprise. Strange thing we seem to see a beast so wild. So she is wild. She was wild, but she's tamed in the course of the poem, but by her own free will. So in order to be conquered, she must desire her own conquest. So it is only when he gives up on her that she returns. So in sonnet number 65, he says that loyal love had bound. So it's not really a conquest, but it's loyal love because she comes here with her own free will. And in sonnet number 67, we have an abstract condition rather than a love situation. And in Emirati, there is never a description. He does not describe the love. There's no specific detail of the love situation, but only an abstract condition. So he's not concerned with the individual, rather, he concerns himself with the relationship at large. And also, if you look at sonnet number 67, it's a miniature of the tradition of all Emirati sonnets. In Petrarch's sonnet, we see that the lady changes, the poet changes, and overall the situation changes. And here, the turn in sonnet number 67, this turn is somewhat Petrarch-like. And Spenser, if we look at him, he's truer Petrarch than any other Petrarchan sonneteer. But he has his own transformations to make, which makes him even more Petrarch-like. So in Petrarch, the love is unconsummated because the beloved dies at the end. But Spenser replaces it with marriage. He ties her, a knot. So he rejects Tasso's idea of platonic love, that platonic love is superior to physical realm. He rejects Dante's or Petrarch's Catholic or Pauline conception that the truly spiritual love is the celibate one. So he's somewhat Protestant. His ideologies or his religious beliefs are Protestant. So the Protestant repudiation of position that celibacy is something superior state. So here we have mutuality and equality, which is necessary for married life. This is not just a chase for a woman, a lustful chase, but rather he wants to get married to her. He ties a knot with her. So Spenser replaces it, the instability in Petrarch with stability, and he overthrows a number of ideas of sonnets, and he comes up with his own tradition, his own transformation, which makes him even more Petrarch-like. Because as we see, Petrarch shifted from the norms of 14th century, and he shifted from the norms of his century. So that's it for today. If you have any doubts, please let me know. Have a good day.